Okay, good afternoon, everybody, and welcome back. We hope you had a good lunch, and now we're going to go straight to business and go into our third session of this seminar. We're now going to move to a more technical topic on the role of statistics in payments and financial inclusion policy, because, as you know, numbers and data are the best backup for any discussion. Remember to share your comments and photos on Twitter under the hashtag Ecom4Dev, and also invite your colleagues who couldn't join us today to follow us live on YouTube through the channel Comex Communication. I want to welcome here on my left side, Mr. Michael Florentino. He is the lead economist in the World Bank Trade and Competitiveness Global Practice, and also Mr. Torbjørn Fredriksson, who is the head of the IT analysis section at ACTAD. Michael holds a PhD from Yale University, and he has published research on a wide array of topics relating to international trade, including non-tariff measures and trade facilitation, global value chains, the relationship of trade to the environment, innovation, and productivity, among others. And Torbjørn is, among other things, responsible for UNCTAD's annual information economic report, leads the e-trade for all initiative, and for 8 years was one of the principal authors of the World Investment Report. He holds a Master of Science in International Economics from the Stockholm School of Economics. Both panelists and experts will give an overview of the existing initiatives to improve digital economy statistics in the area of payments and mobile money. And we will afterwards encourage your participation by discussing additional data points to help understand the national situations and the trade and non-trade related policy priorities that should be considered. So after saying this, I would like to give the floor to Michael for his intervention. So you have the floor. Thank you very much, Michael.
Thank you.
Microphone, please.
There we go. So we always, in any area of policy, especially a new and emergent one, we are looking to make recommendations on what to do, not only on our instinct and expert opinion, but on an evidence-based basis. And so inevitably, we want to go about collecting data so that we can measure this, and you know, that can be a great source of progress in this area. Since this is a new and emerging area, there are a lot of challenges, but there are two types of things we'd like to measure. The first is how much e-commerce is going on in the world, and second, what are the features of the enabling environment that, if they exist more of or in higher quality, might encourage more e-commerce. And so I'm going to try to give a brief summary of what it is that we think we know right now and how we're trying to disseminate more information for the global community. So in conjunction with the E-Trade for All initiative, which Torbjørn is going to be talking about, we are putting together a set of E-Trade for All indicators. In fact, they're put down. They are put together. They are very close to release. And these cover not only payment solutions, which you see there in the powder blue, but six other things as well, because we're spending today talking about how important payments are, but other things are important as well. For example, ICT infrastructure and services. You have to be online to do anything online. Do you have a mobile phone? Are you on the internet? Trade logistics and trade facilitation. This not only includes the traditional topics in trade facilitation that you think of when you think of the trade facilitation agreement, things having to do with customs, but also things having to do with the mail and postal service, because this is an important part of the e-commerce environment, which is, you know, present in some places and absent elsewhere. e-commerce skills development. Are firms used to using email, ICT, and whatnot in their daily business? Legal and regulatory frameworks, and you've heard some discussion of these this morning. We have a few examples of each of these variables here, and in this case, some of the examples are simply binary things. Is there a legal framework in a given country for electronic transactions or e-signatures? Is there a data protection framework or a consumer protection framework or laws related to cybercrime? You know, and just, you know, this is, again, a first attempt to pull these things together. If you're actually a legal expert in, you know, any of these topics, then you would probably want to know not only is there a consumer protection law, but what protections does it contain? So this is just an entry point. Access to financing. Is working capital financed by banks, for example? Do firms say that they are constrained? And then e-commerce readiness assessment and strategy formulation. What we do actually is pull together several other indices which have already been put together by different organizations. UNCTAD has an index of e-commerce readiness. The International Telecommunications Union has an index of ICT readiness. And the World Economic Forum has one of network readiness. So we provide these indicators and show, you know, along with all these other sort of individual standalone bits of information, over 30 of them, that, you know, so you can build your own index and just look at things one at a time. On payment solutions, I want to make note of the fact that this conference has actually given us an opportunity to improve this product. You only see measures here of debit cards, credit cards. You might ask about mobile money. We looked in mobile money for one place, didn't find it. And it turns out that there are data on mobile money in another part of the World Bank, which is a typical sort of thing. You know, when you've got 10,000 people, you don't know what everybody's doing, you know. So I've just contacted my office, having learned this at lunch, and we do plan to have mobile money in the database. So here's some examples of some of the things we can find out about payments. This, by the way, comes from a large survey-based data set called Global Findex, which you can find online and access. So this is just a taste of that. And so this is a share of the population 15 years and over with a credit card, and it varies widely. And it's not only that, in some countries there's very little credit card access, and in others there's a great deal, but even among high-income countries, the use of credit cards varies a lot more than you would think. And we see actually that the prevalence of e-commerce varies as well. We can ask about debit cards, okay, and that information is there as well. And you might think that in a country where 40% of the people have credit cards, 40% would also have debit cards. Well, that's true in Bahrain, but in Armenia, about twice as many people have a debit card as have a credit card. And we can look at another dimension of this as well. Sometimes people have these things, but they haven't used them in a year or more. And we have separate variables that capture whether or not people have used their credit card or debit card in the last year. So we are rolling these things out through several means of dissemination in the next 6 weeks or so, so that there's two different platforms. One is the Trade and Competitiveness Data Portal. There's the link up there, tcdata360.worldbank.org. You'll find a lot of nice country data there right now. You can do things like look at time series map data. At the World Integrated Trade Solution, WITS, which is probably familiar to anybody who's had to handle a lot of merchandise trade data, and at the E-Trade for All online platform, where the data will likely have a different look like a series of country-specific PDFs. And so there will be additional functionality added to the E-Trade for all indicators in every one of the portals, depending on what is the style in which data is traditionally portrayed there already. Now, here's the big question. What we'd like to do, if we have a good picture of the e-commerce environment, is to say which of these various indicators seem to be really closely related with having a lot of e-commerce and which seem to be less relevant. In order to do that, we'd like to be able to measure e-commerce, how much is going on. And here is the part which is a good deal more challenging. And what's being measured here is the dollar value of retail e-commerce, or what's sometimes called B2C, business-to-consumer e-commerce, in selected developing countries. And I want to call a couple of things to your attention. First, that everywhere we can see this, it's growing really rapidly. So the blue bar is 2010, the orange ones are 2015, and in Indonesia, over in this five-year period, e-commerce looks like it more than doubles every year. In Brazil, which starts off a higher base, it doubles every 3 to 4 years. Now, why do I show you these particular countries? It turns out that even a basic measure like this, how much are consumers buying online, is only available, as far as I can tell, for about 36 countries. And yeah, so in terms of developing countries, I've basically shown you the ones that I have other than China. And the reason that I don't show you China is that China does perhaps over half of all the retail e-commerce buying in the world. And if I put that on the graph, everybody else would become very difficult to read. So what are the challenges in terms of measuring e-commerce itself? We can do a lot with the enabling environment, but what can we see? As I just mentioned, right now, I can only see measures of e-commerce for a few dozen countries, and they're usually retail e-commerce. They're not standardized. For example, if I look at what the EU puts out in Eurostat, they may tell me what percentage of firms sell something online, whereas the United States may give dollar values of how much of every type of commerce is e-commerce, and they may break it down by sectors. So there's not an international data standard for this stuff. And a lot of the data are in private hands, which is why some of our most valuable lessons about e-commerce, such as the fact that it enables SMEs and enormously reduces trade costs and so on, are things that we've learned from academics who've managed to partner with online platforms like eBay and get their private data. In fact, these figures are not official figures here at all. You'll notice there's a source there, eMarketer. So that's actually data that we had to pay for to get access to that. Now, another question that people ask are how much business-to-business or wholesale e-commerce is going on here. And this is where our ability to have any sort of radar for what's going on is frustrating, because in what we think from a couple of data points we have is that business-to-business e-commerce is much larger than retail e-commerce. Maybe it could be a factor of 5, maybe more or less. We can only see that maybe for 2 or 3 countries. For the 130, 140 countries for which at least I don't have a figure for even how much retail e-commerce is going on, it is probably going on practically everywhere, okay? And the reason why I wanted to show you the growth for the countries I could see is that Quite often people say, this isn't even an activity in my country. There are no jobs being generated by e-commerce. And if, you know, for example, if I take the example of Brazil, and if somebody is selling $14 billion worth of whatever it is that they are selling through this method, I don't understand how that generates zero jobs, okay? And so anywhere we work now, my first question is already, what is already going on? So we're in the process of developing a project at the World Bank called Digital Myanmar. And my assumption isn't that nothing is going on in Myanmar. My assumption is that once we start to look, we are actually going to find a couple of intrepid entrepreneurs building platforms, selling goods and services against incredible odds where their environment isn't enabled. And I want to talk to them first to find out what constraints they face. Another limitation is that we don't know very much about how whether e-commerce is cross-border or domestic. And of course, at the WTO, we tend to focus on international trade. That's something that we need to know more about. And again, with a few exceptions like the United States, we don't know what kinds of goods and services are being traded. So we're very far from having anything on e-commerce that looks like the merchandise trade data, but at least we know what we like. And so now that the discussion is starting to be underway in the international statistical system about how could we go about collecting data like this systematically and perhaps recommending a data standard for countries who want to do this the first time, at least we have some idea of what's on our wish list. And that's what I have for now. Thanks.
Well, Michael, thank you very much for a very interesting presentation. I think you have clearly highlighted what we can measure, what is available today, but at the same time, pointing out the challenges ahead and the things that we need to deepen the understanding in order to continue to understand better how all this affects countries and trade and so on. So now I would like to turn to Torbjörn, who will present on payments for e-commerce and some reflections on this matter. So thank you very much, Torbjörn, and the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Mr. Ambassador. It's great to be back again among the friends of e-commerce for development. I'd like to thank the Friends of E-commerce for Development for taking the initiative to organizing this seminar, which I can tell from the attendance here has a lot of interest here in Geneva. Also, many thanks to Michael for a very informative presentation. Maybe I can just, before going to my planned presentation, just add some brief reflections on some of the work that we're doing now in UNCTAD. On trying to dig deeper into this statistical challenge of e-commerce. And for instance, one of the countries that is really making a great effort in collecting data on e-commerce is the UK. And they have recently come up with new information that is quite revealing. For instance, we have also had this tendency of equating more or less retail e-commerce with B2C, business to consumer e-commerce. The UK data show that that is not really feasible. In fact, in the UK, it only accounts for about 25% coming out from the retail sector. And a lot of it is coming actually from wholesale businesses that are going straight to the consumers. They're jumping over the retail stage there. They're still business to consumers. Our data suggests among the top 10 countries of the world in terms of e-commerce markets that B2B is probably about 90% of the total, 90% of the B2C plus B2C market. So underlying again the enormous importance of B2B. And then another challenge here that we're facing is of course how to collect data in this area. If you approach the consumers, you get one type of information, but you will only reach the B2C or C2C aspect. If you go to enterprises and ask them who they are selling to and so on, you may be able to capture both B2B and B2C. So that is perhaps something to keep in mind. Now, what I would like to do in my presentation is just to share some other types of statistics and pieces of information that may be relevant as we think about the role of payments in support of e-commerce in developing countries. And just to start by stressing that payment solutions, as many of you are aware, is one of the seven policy areas of E-Trade for All, the initiative that we launched last July. We are very happy here to work closely with the World Bank as the leading agency, I would say, in the area of payment solutions. Now, if we look at just some scattered evidence that we have in this area, you can see, for instance, in South Africa here, that one third of the internet users who do not make purchases online, they state that they do not trust online payments as the second most important reason for not engaging in e-commerce, and which underlines then why we need to pay attention to the payments dimension in the case of e-commerce. We recently did some work also in Cambodia, and there you can also see the top bottlenecks identified by the stakeholders that were interviewed and surveyed during late 2016. And you see that the fourth highest, but it's actually from fourth from the bottom, is the lack of payment methods for e-commerce. So again, it features quite highly on the priorities of countries. You may have noticed that one of the indicators that Michael included in the E-Trade for All indicators of e-commerce readiness was related to credit cards. And this is, of course, an area where we, thanks to the World Bank, have quite good data on the availability and use of such cards. But it's also that we can see from the work of WorldPay that credit cards and other cards, they are lumped under the heading of credit cards here. So this actually includes both credit and debit cards, is the most popular way of paying for business to consumer e-commerce around the world. And you see that in 2014, credit cards and other cards accounted for more than half of e-commerce payments in terms of value. And then you see that another 22% was accounted for by e-wallets like PayPal and other methods. The projection, though, is that by 2019, the share of credit cards will have shrunk below 50% and that the e-wallet aspect will have grown. Another thing to observe is that there is a small slice called other, and under that heading you have the mobile money payments, and that is also growing a little bit from 5 to 7%. But you should also note there that cash on delivery is not expected to decline in the relative share of all e-commerce payments. And we heard this morning that in a number of countries, it's still like 90% of all e-commerce is paid by cash on delivery when it comes to business to consumers. Maybe it's worth noting here also that this is, again, e-commerce, domestic, cross-border, what have you, it's e-commerce. But if we look at some other recent studies that have looked only at cross-border e-commerce for consumers, then there's a slightly different picture. And the e-wallets aspect is actually the most important. This was a study that was recently produced by the International Post Corporation in 26 countries, only looking at cross-border e-commerce, where PayPal and other e-wallets accounted for 41% of the payments, and credit cards were in the second place at 33%. So that is perhaps also something to keep in mind, that there may be different scenarios here and different preferences when it comes to cross-border elements. The mobile money we talked about this morning, and this is just to show this is the latest numbers from GSMA, and we can see this rather dramatic increase in the number of mobile money deployments around the world. And I think the latest number for 2016 is that there are 277 such deployments. What is interesting is, of course, that most of these are in sub-Saharan Africa and in South Asia, really reflecting the need for additional financial services or solutions in these markets. The GSMA is also looking at what kind of activities are undertaking on the basis of the mobile money. And you can see that almost, well, a bit more than two-thirds is basically people-to-people transfers still in these systems. So it's not really e-commerce as such. But you can see that the what is called merchant payment accounts for almost about 5% of these transactions. And I think this is an area that is growing particularly fast in the mobile money world. Then we also talked about this morning about that there's no one-size-fits-all, and I think this slide is pointing in that direction. You can see in China, for instance, Alipay is the most popular solution for online shopping, where 68% of online shoppers are using it, and only 16% of the population in China has actually a credit card. And the Alipay is like an escrow accounts solution, which is very popular there. In Kenya, of course, the mobile money is more important than credit cards for e-commerce payments, but cash on delivery is still, at least in the numbers that we have, which went dated back to 2014, then cash on delivery was still more important. But this is, I suppose, just a question of time before that changes as well. And I included Brazil here. I'm not too familiar with Brazil's situation, but just to illustrate that there's a lot of innovation going on here, how to connect what's going on online with what's going on offline. Vostu is an online game developer, and they have partnered with about 150,000 physical points where people that are active online playing their games can go and buy credits to engage in these games. So then you connect the offline and the online world in this area. Now I'm going to skip that in the interest of time. Now, we noticed that, especially for cross-border and for business to consumers, the platforms, the e-wallets, are very, very important as a mechanism for making payments for e-commerce. And, of course, the most widespread and most widely used in this context is PayPal. And these data are not fully up to date, but the principle remains that not all countries have access to PayPal accounts. And there are different types of accounts that PayPal offers. And if you are a merchant and you want to sell your stuff online, you really want to have a business account. And this has other implications also. I understand, for instance, from eBay that they will not localize their activities in a country if you cannot have a business account in that country. So it has sort of repercussions of the status of PayPal's presence in a country. This is something that one should keep in mind, because that makes it easier if you're in a country where you have a personal account to buy from someone, but it's more difficult for you to sell to another country to get financial compensation. Let me end with two insights from our work in Cambodia, and what kind of bottlenecks that were identified in terms of the payments landscape. It's very much related to the cash-based society. Point of sales payments are only available in US dollars for the time being, which makes it difficult for many local people to get engaged in these electronic transactions. Cards, to the extent that they are used mainly for cash withdrawals at automatic teller machines. There is currently no shared national switch for card-based electronic payments, so there is not the interoperability in place. Only one bank offers access to deposit accounts via debit cards. And a lot of people are flagging the high costs and risks of credit card processing. So this is a range of issues that are arising from dialogues with stakeholders on the ground in Cambodia. And when they are asked what should be done to improve the payment situation for e-commerce, then the most popular two examples are that is related to educational initiatives on security and trust building for policymakers, banks, merchants, and consumers, and regulations that allow for mobile payments. Then we also ask, how important would it be to receive technical assistance in this area? And then the top one is the educational initiatives, and followed by clear and interoperable consumer protection regulations in this field. And this question of technical assistance is asked simply in Cambodia because we want to see how we can feed this kind of information to the work that we're doing in the context of e-trade for all. This is a commercial. The payments dimension will be further discussed during the e-commerce week at the end of April. And I should stress that together with the World Bank, we will also have a session on measuring e-commerce more broadly. And I expect that both these sessions will zero in on how we can make ourselves more effective in supporting developing countries to addressing the various challenges that we are facing in this area. Thank you very much.
Well, Thunbjorn, thank you very much for a very good and also very informative presentation. For me, it was very interesting to note several things that you mentioned, the relevance of B2B transactions in e-commerce, the difference of payment methods when you compare domestic to cross-border, the different pictures that this is taking in different countries, and also, of course, the last part about the bottlenecks that have been identified for e-transactions in specific countries. So after these two very good presentations now, I would like to open the floor for questions of the audience. We have here these two experts, so it would be very good that we take advantage to ask them any questions. If you could please identify yourself by name and occupation before asking any questions. So the floor is yours.
Thank you. I'm Suleiman Audu from Nigerian Mission. We do appreciate this very interesting and very insightful presentation. Just a quick question as to the status of the e-commerce readiness assessment. Similar to trade facilitation, prior to that, there used to be an encouragement that each country should undertake its need assessment and priority. And I want to know whether there is collaboration between UNCTAD and the World Bank in terms of what countries need to do in terms of ensuring that their e-commerce readiness is something that can guarantee their ability to be able to effectively engage in the process. But more importantly, what is the status of the ongoing work? Is it on the basis of request by members, or there's a particular focus on certain countries? I mean, where exactly are we in relation to that? And I think it will help if you can ascertain the status and to see how we can follow up on that, I think.
Yes.
Yep. Thank you very much for the question. And I'll start. Maybe Michael wants to add something on this. Very good question, actually, and very timely as well. As far as UNCTAD's work in this field, I'll start with that. We can offer two kinds of support in this area. We have a program that is labeled ICT Policy Reviews, where we can go quite in depth into countries to help develop, for instance, e-commerce strategies. And this is what we have basically just concluded with Egypt, and that strategy will be presented during the e-commerce week here in Geneva, in the presence of the Minister of ICT. Then we are also doing that kind of work with Rwanda for the time being. And we have requests from a number of other African countries. And this, then we're talking about like a year-long exercise where we really go into the depth, in depth in all relevant areas, and try to come up with concrete recommendations for the governments how to move forward, how to improve, and engage with the relevant stakeholders, either inside the country or external partners. But UNCTAD is not an expert in every area of e-commerce. So, for instance, in the case of Egypt, we had excellent collaboration with the World Bank, who helped us with the payments module in that context. We also had close collaboration with the Universal Postal Union to bring in the role of the post in this area, and also, of course, inputs from the International Trade Center on the question of SME capacity building, and other partners. But these are long-term activities, and they are a bit costly. So it sometimes takes a little while to have the funding mechanisms in place. And this is, of course, an encouragement to all the donors to be generous. Then we have also developed, which is more of along the lines of what we did with Cambodia and also Bhutan, which we originally said would focus only on the least developed countries, because we see that that's where the greatest needs are right now, to enable the least developed countries to have a basic understanding of where they stand in terms of e-commerce or e-trade readiness. And here we have developed a project proposal, and we have, but I cannot announce anything yet, but we have very strong indications that some donors will come to our aid, and which we expect will allow us to roll out probably another 5 or 6 such assessments during 2017, especially in the LDCs, and hopefully around 15 in 2018. But we haven't approached the least developed countries yet in terms of encouraging them to request such assistance until we knew that the funding would be available. But as soon as we do, we will encourage member states that are interested in approaching us to seek that kind of assistance. But in parallel, we also have some other donors that are showing interest, and we will see if we cannot also expand this effort to reach beyond the LDCs to other developing countries. So there are like 2 tracks. One is the rapid assessments that would take about a month to complete in a country, and this bigger e-commerce strategy development, which is like a year-long exercise.
Thank you very much, Torbjörn. I think Michael will also like to comment on this.
Yeah, and I would like to reemphasize what Torbjörn mentioned, which is that actually to get a hold on strategy formation, it's important to look at a lot of things in depth. When you get the indicators that we just described, the intent is to cover the whole world as best we can, and the thing which somebody could do at their desktop is probably most fruitfully some comparisons with countries in your region or a similar stage of development, and then you can say, oh, well, we seem to be a bit ahead on payments, but maybe not as far on how many people have the internet in the first place, or entrepreneurial skills, or trade facilitation. But generally, in order to integrate these things, it's important to actually engage not only with governments, but with entrepreneurs, and find out what is your perception of the greatest impediments, because statistics alone don't necessarily do this. And I will say that in many cases where we have an engagement in the World Bank, and we have engagements in most of these areas that the indicators cover, there's at least some subject matter expertise. The country already has some idea what their priorities are, that their priority is infrastructure, expanding broadband, and can they talk about a loan for undersea cable? Or sometimes it is building a trade information portal, possibly for some of their work in the trade facilitation agreement, and that will involve the team that does that looking at the national internet law, or an activity having to do with entrepreneurship will generally not only be country-specific, but it may operate through incubators and accelerators and become actually firm-specific and entrepreneur-specific. And so what we actually learn from countries as to their own perceptions of their priorities is at least as important, and probably more important, than what one can simply just extract from indicators.
Well, thank you very much to both of you. Any other questions? Yes, please, over there.
Pierre Sauvé from the World Bank. This is a very sobering discussion, in a way. 2017, we are not able, really, to say what share of world trade takes place digitally. And it's not your fault, of course, but it's a real challenge for policymaking. I remember early on in the Uruguay round, when we were discussing services, I remember the Indian ambassador. At the time, India was very opposed to the very notion of discussing services multilaterally, and he said, how can we negotiate what we cannot measure? And I wonder to what extent does the paucity of data stand in the way of more coherent rulemaking in this area? Because there is seemingly momentum building up in doing something about e-commerce, but how much of an impediment to doing something useful is held up by the paucity of data? And a second point is the role of investment. I didn't really hear much about investment. A lot of e-commerce, I suspect, but I'm not an expert, takes place within national markets rather than across borders. And it occurs through foreign investment serving e-commerce domestically, either because of policy or for other reasons. The examples that Juan gave us this morning in finance were, I thought, were very revealing of a lot of operations where banks are establishing, or other types of financial institutions are establishing, beachheads in different markets. There's not much trade between these beachheads necessarily, except in some market segments, but investment is driving e-commerce. And I was wondering if you could perhaps say a few words about whether or not we're trying to measure investment flows in digital trade or in digital activities.
Thank you very much. Michael, you'd like to comment on that?
Yeah, well, I mean, to some extent, we may be able to measure investment flows in information and communications technology, but that's a sort of different thing. I would say that some of this activity is definitely driven by foreign investment. So, for example, Amazon is building warehouses in India right now, and yet, as they do this, they go into competition with domestic platforms like Flipkart, who are doing the exact same type of things within the country. So that goes on, but then at the same time, the nature of e-commerce is such that the investment doesn't necessarily, a lot of it, have to take place in the buyer's market or whatever. One can do e-commerce in a given country as a foreigner, if your server farm is buried under the desert of New Mexico, so it's not the sort of thing you'd think. At the same time, there is an enormous amount, I mean, this is all anecdotal, but there are a lot of country-specific platforms, there are a lot of city-specific services. If you live in a metropolitan area where you can go online and, have your lunch delivered from hundreds of restaurants, there are urban centers in developing countries where the same sort of activity happens, and that's all domestic. So I actually don't feel like I'm in a position to say X percent of this thing we cannot measure is associated with FDI. That's sort of more unknowable.
Thank you very much, Michael. Turn your turn to talk about this very interesting way to look at things.
Yeah, because it's a very good question. It's fundamental in a sense here. And it is unfortunately the case that we don't have good data in this area after all the talk about e-commerce. But to be fair, it's only, I would say, in the past 3 years that we have really started work talking about e-commerce in earnest here in Geneva. So we're seeing a rapid increase in the interest here, and that is also why the lack of data becomes so glaringly apparent, I would say. You asked specifically if this is a problem for rule-making discussions here. I think first and foremost, it is a problem for countries in terms of any kind of policy making in this area, because if you cannot describe what the benchmark is right now, it's very difficult to also identify what I need to do to improve and also to measure whether what I'm doing is actually having the effects that I would like to have in this area. And of course, if it's difficult at the national level, it becomes even more difficult to then agree on international policy making in this area. We are trying with our colleagues in other international organizations to address this area. We have there was a discussion on this at the G20 meeting recently in Berlin. And we have set up a special working group with the WTO, with UPU, with the OECD, and we're hoping that the World Bank will soon come in as well, to focus specifically on cross-border e-commerce. And very few countries have data on this area, and those that have are mainly from developed countries. We have two interesting examples from Canada and Spain. And the interesting thing there is that in both countries, about 80% of the e-commerce that they report is domestic. 15% in the case of Canada goes to the US, and 50% in Spain goes to the rest of the EU, and 5% goes to the rest of the world. So that's sort of grosso modo what the picture looks like from those countries that have this kind of information.
So just thinking about economic institutions, I mean, as much as I want better data, it isn't clear to me that there is an automatic requirement to have measurement in order to have rulemaking. What you have to have for rulemaking is to understand what the phenomena is. In fact, there have been rules about commerce about international commerce for centuries in the absence of measurement. There were an elaborate set of rules to operate the Champagne Fair in the 14th century, and I think no data on how much business was transacted there. And if I could pick a more relevant, you know, possibly contemporary example, there was a government procurement agreement in the early 1990s. And I think if you look up how much international data there were on government procurement in the early 1990s, you won't find much, but all that was needed was at least the countries who participated in that to understand what happens when governments buy things.
Thank you very much, Michael. I think Torbjörn wants to comment again on the investment question. This was a very good question, by the way. So,
just on the investment issue, there, it's absolutely right that in many developing countries, it's a foreign owner or foreign equity partner, at least, that goes in to invest in the country. Like Jumia, it was supported or has been supported with Rocket Internet from Germany, and there are a number of services-oriented e-commerce companies in Africa that are supported by Ringier, a Swiss company. But for all these companies that are considering whether they want to invest directly in e-commerce or in the ecosystem of e-commerce, in transportation, payments, and so on, having better data on the landscape or the ecosystem for e-commerce will be very valuable to assess the risks and the likely profits that they can make from this. So it's not only important for policymakers, but also for decision makers in business. And that's why we want to have these rapid assessments now off the ground, so that we at least have some kind of a baseline information in more and more countries.
Thank you very much. I have a question here from Ambassador Valerio.
Thank you. Just a brief question concerning cross-border. Customs in some countries must know what's going on this, because there are some limitations going on in some countries. There are thresholds on the value of the transaction. There are also limitations on the number of transactions that an individual can do and buying abroad. And there are limitations on volume in some countries too. So in some ways, probably local commerce won't appreciate too much the increase of this kind of trade. So we have to be careful on this too. I'd like to listen to some comments on that.
Yeah, sure. I think so. At the World Bank, we actually are working with about 40 countries on implementation of the Trade Facilitation Agreement. And there is actually a lively awareness of the link between trade facilitation and e-commerce. That we know, for example, that restrictive de minimis requirements that require calculating the duty on very small shipments are discouraging of e-commerce, and we know that a customs regime that privileges large containers over small parcels is similarly not going to be good for e-commerce. And so operationally on the ground, when we have an opportunity to work with a country on customs reform, these issues come up. That doesn't necessarily mean that we know anything about these data issues. Customs can be aware of this, and yet if a shipment comes into the country and there's no question on the what's the word I'm looking for, on the manifest, you know, if you don't actually ask the shipper, did the customer buy this online or did they call you on the phone, then there's no mechanism to collect that data, at least through customs, which is why the data that we have in a lot of these cases, I think, are attached to instruments like surveys of manufacturers or surveys of retailers or wholesalers.
Just to add a couple of points here. You're absolutely correct that the customs is a huge source of information here. The problem right now is that the way that we collect information on the goods flows across countries, there is no question on how it was ordered. And that means that we lose the e-commerce angle to it. But there is very interesting work there being done with the World Customs Organization and UPU. And I think there is also some thinking about how to improve that situation, to add a question when to capture better data. That would be wonderful. The other thing is, of course, as Ambassador points out here, especially in Latin America, developing countries, we have seen that cross-border e-commerce actually accounts for a much larger share. And it's mainly in terms of imports. And that is a concern for many countries, but it sort of again underlines the importance of seeing how one can strengthen the ability of SMEs and other firms in the Latin American and other developing countries to engage also as exporters in the online market.
Thank you very much. I think there is a question over there. Thank you.
Gracias, embajador.
Thank you, Ambassador. I am just benefiting from the interpreters to ask my question in Spanish. All of this about data leads me to think that we also need a definition of external trade, at least an operational one. I don't know whether you yet have an operational definition, both within UNCTAD or within the World Bank, just to give us some guidance on what it is we need to measure, just a definition of e-commerce.
Okay, that's a very good question. In fact, during the meeting that I mentioned at the G20 in Germany, we devoted many days to discussions about digital trade. But there was no consensus on what digital trade is because there's no clear definition there. And it was sometimes clear that we are coming in from different perspectives. On e-commerce, there is actually a relatively clear definition from a statistical perspective on what e-commerce is. It is, if it is ordered online, it's a bit more complicated, but if it's ordered online, it counts as e-commerce. Then it may be delivered offline or online, and it can be paid for offline or online. But if it is ordered online, it will count as e-commerce. However, in this house, the definition or the description of e-commerce that was presented for the purpose of the work program on e-commerce is much broader. It can be paid online, it could be ordered online, it could be delivered online. So it has a looser description. And I think that it's for reasons of being able to talk about all aspects of this. But I think one issue that is of high importance for the discussions here in WTO and elsewhere is to find out more how much of the trade that is delivered electronically. Because that will be the closest link, for instance, to the electronic transmissions dimension, I think, that is referred to in the context of the moratorium. Here, ANCTAD also, in collaboration with partners, has developed a new methodology to measure what we call ICT-enabled services trade. And the only way we have seen to actually come up with this is to go around and do enterprise surveys in countries and simply ask them how much of these services are delivered electronically as opposed to by someone traveling to the other country to deliver it or by someone coming to you to buy the services. And we are rolling now out pilot studies for Costa Rica, Egypt, Thailand and India this year. And we will take stock at the end of this year. Then we would hope that we can do this on a larger scale for countries so that we actually can have an estimate of how much of services trade is actually delivered electronically, which we don't have right now. The first country to test this methodology was the United States. And they basically reorganized their statistics from the BOP statistics and calculated the share of what they call digitally deliverable services, not digitally delivered services, because they don't know. They haven't asked that question, but they say this is the maximum amount, according to the data that the methodology that we have proposed, that could have been delivered digitally. And I understand, at least last time I spoke with colleagues in the Department of Commerce, that there could be opportunities for the U.S. to do something, to also go and ask the question how much was actually delivered there. But this is an area that I think more countries will need to look at.
Well, thank you very much. I was wondering if there would be any other questions. If not, then I would like to thank you both for the very, very good presentation. I think that we have seen how this matter of the statistics and the numbers is very important. I guess it was important not just because of the answers, but also because of the questions, because then you can see how many things are still pending to have a clear picture, and it's so important in this discussion. So thank you very much again, and also to the audience for the questions. And now, as we move on our seminar, I would like to, we will continue discussing what attracts digital financial services providers to offer services in developing economies. This is a session that will be chaired by Ambassador Banerio of Uruguay. So I invite him and the next panelist to please come to the podium. Thank you very much.